Thank you very much, Alina, and also thank you very much, Philippe and Michael, for this invitation. So it's always very nice to be able to speak at the Number Theory Web Seminar and also to watch other seminars. So it's a great service to the community, I think. And okay, so I will speak of some joint work and still ongoing work with my usual co-conspirator, Etienne Fouvry, Emmanuel Kowalski, and Will Sawin. And so, yeah, this is something a little bit exotic, mixed moment for Dirichlet L functions. And so, okay, how? Ah, yeah. So, the main characters are the L function associated to Dirichlet characters, so degree one L function, the next step after Riemann zeta function. So as you know, these are Dirichlet series, which also are Euler products, and they admit the usual functional equation when you complete them with some adequate gamma factors, which depend on the parity of the character. And they have, and it would be very important for us, they have the functional equation as a sign, which is a complex number, which is essentially a normalized Gauss sum, so this epsilon chi. So the one of the things one we would like to understand are the moments of this L function. So we want to evaluate several averages of values of these Dirichlet L functions on average over the group of characters modulo Q, and for me Q will be a prime. And so we have these moments where you can take your special value of Dirichlet function and take it to the power k, and you can also take the complex conjugate and take it to another power l and make the product and try to evaluate this average. So we will focus on a special point for the complex variable s, which will be the center of symmetry, so the point 1/2, which is probably the most interesting, but it's merely to fix ideas. And the goal is to say that evaluate these moments when Q goes to infinity, and we hope to be able to isolate some main term and up to an error term. And as we will see, usually this main term will be essentially bounded or will grow very slowly. In fact, it's not a Q to a little O of one, but it's more like of the size of a power of log of Q. And then you can do variants for this moment for various purposes, so such that amplifying the moment or mollifying the moment. So the very first moment is a moment of order one, the first moment, and it's just the average of the value at 1/2. And I don't know who evaluated this moment for the very first time, but what you get is that this average is one up to an error term, which is a negative power of Q. So on average, these L functions are equal to one, this value at 1/2. And okay, it's not very difficult. And so now you go with higher order moments, so moments of order two, and then you have two possibilities essentially. So either you take the square of the modulus of your central value, or you can take the pure square without the absolute value, and you get two different results. So you can evaluate these two moments up to again an error term which is a negative power of q, and if for the square of the modulus you get as a, in the main term log q plus some constant, and if you take the pure square you just get one. So this indicates first that so we have seen that on average the first moment is equal to one, but when you go and take the square of the modulus, you see a log q as a main term. So this indicates that some L values can grow at least up to square root of log q. But if when you take the pure square, you get a one, and it tells you that L values, these are complex numbers, they want to be one on average, but still there is some oscillation which kind of destroy this log q factor and make it go back to one. And also this second moment, this pure square moment, it is interesting because it's a special case of another kind of moment. You can say that this is the first moment of the L function of a modular form twisted by this Dirichlet character at the central point, and in that case the modular form is an Eisenstein, non-holomorphic Eisenstein series at the central point, and you have to take the first derivative. And but then you can evaluate more general moments where this Eisenstein series is replaced by, for instance, a fixed cusp form. Okay, so now we go to free. And then you have also a variety of cases because you can take or not complex conjugates. So you have a moment of order free, which is due to DAS and CAN. And so you take it's a moment maybe you take two you take the square of L chi 1/2 and you take one complex conjugate, or you take a modular form which you twist by your Dirichlet character and multiply by the complex conjugate, and so then you get as a result the L function at one of, so I think they did it when F was a cusp form, but you can do it also for the moment to one. And so you obtain a main term, which is non-zero, plus this error term, which is again some negative power of Q. So the other option is a pure cubic moment. So the L function of your Dirichlet series taken to the cube. And this is Jan Petro who showed me this this computation for the first time, I think. And so the proof, the evaluation of this cubic moment, it's quite elaborate, it's quite tricky because it uses the work of Friedlander Ivaniec on the ternary divisor function in large arithmetic progressions. And then you can also try to do other moment of that kind. So instead of a pure cube, you can replace one square with a twist by say a modular form, say a cusp form, and this one done by Raphael Zacharias in his thesis. And there it's a bit more difficult, so you need more more artillery than the pure cubic case because you have maybe less factorization with this Dirichlet series. Okay, so these are the cubic moments, classical cubic moment, and then we go to moments of order four, and there you have much less things that are known. So you have the moment 2-2, so which is the fourth power of the modulus of your d'Iriclet Series, Central Values, which, and this is a celebrated work of Matthew Young. And he showed that this fourth moment can be evaluated asymptotically, and it is equal to a polynomial of degree 3 in log Q for the main term, and you have an error term again with a negative power of Q. And you have a variant of this when you replace Eisenstein series by modular form, CUS form, for instance. So, and this is a joint work with Valentin Blomer, so ourselves and Giorgio Milicevic, when we could evaluate this moment of now two modular forms. And one is twisted by the Dirichlet character chi, and the other is twisted by the complex conjugate of the same character. And then you get some asymptotic formula. And I think basically this is it. So I don't think one knows, says a moment of order form, a type of free one, or the pure fourth moment of Dirichlet L function. So, and it seems a very hard problem. And in fact, it's a very important question of being able to evaluate this pure fourth moment. It's also connected to the work of Conray Ivaniec on some cubic moment of twisted L function. So, okay, so, but as far as I know, we don't have evaluation for these other moments of order four. And you have, for higher moments, you have some other works, but I think these require additional averagings over the modulus. So, for instance, you have the work of Conray, Ivaniec, and Sandar Arajan for the moment of order six, with six power of the absolute value, but you need to average over the modulus Q. Okay, so now I will pass to the mixed moment, so which is the main topic of this talk. And the data that you have is you take a tuple of integers, positive or negative, and then you consider this mixed moment, which is again the average over the family of Dirichlet character modulo Q of the product of the L functions, where each character is raised to the power the ith entry of your tuple. So for instance, the moment 1, 2, 3 is a cubic moment over all Dirichlet characters of the Dirichlet L series at chi, the Dirichlet L series at chi square, and the Dirichlet series at chi cube. Okay, and you can replace the cube with minus 3 if you'd like, so take also complex conjugate into the mix. So, and if you want, if you can play with this, you can consider further variants where you can introduce shift, twist, so multiply by the value of at some integer of your character, and multiply your characters, possibly with some power, by extra, so you can make a shift kind of by chi1, chi2, or chi3, and try to evaluate this. And okay, whenever we can do the regular mixed moment, then often one can do shifts and twists if one needs to. Okay, and so yeah, this is a bit exotic, but I would like to say that this kind of moment already occurred before, Although it is quite recent, so Javier Pliego considered the analog for the Riemann zeta function. So you try to evaluate the integral of the value of the Riemann zeta function along the critical line. But what you have is that you have say free entries and you vary at different speed along the critical line. So you have say zeta 1/2 plus it, zeta 1/2 plus I plus 2 it, and zeta 1/2 plus 3 it. And you multiply the three and try to evaluate the average. And Pliego was able to evaluate these moments, this Archimedean moment, with a power saving error term. And you see, if you you get a different answer depending on whether you have all the direction, all the speed in the which are all positive, or you have some speed which are negative. Okay, here you don't like get logarithmic factors log t, because and for any other moment that we will do also, because there is no conspiracy in terms of size, because you are doing something which is cubic, so you have no chance to compensate one thing with its complex conjugate. Or okay, so is it clear, or are there questions? Or so this is our setup. And maybe I want to say, if one try to generalize this kind of question, you could try to think in terms of general average of moment of L function in over family of automorphic representations.
A moment,
yes.
You asked that question, so. You said there is no conspiracy in this averaging. Suppose you take a combination which is very famous from this trigonometric inequality in the prime number theorem.
Oh, does it have three terms?
Well, yes, but there are powers. Right?
Okay, I will. Okay. Adam Arc de la Vallée. Okay.
Yeah?
Adam, okay. But
there may be some conspiracy. I don't know.
Okay, I will take that. Okay, very good proposal. Okay, yeah, I will check this. Okay, so in what you could do if you want to generalize this is you pick a family of automorphic representation for some reductive group, then you take a finite set of representation of the L group of this reductive group, and then associated to this you can form L function, and in some cases you know their analytic properties, and then you can take the product of these L functions and try to average this moment. So that's the natural generalization of what I have explained so far in a very elementary setting. And so it looks a bit abstract, but these kind of problems, they really occur in nature. For instance, if you look at problems connected to quantum unique ergodicity or the random wave conjecture for modular form, you face the question of evaluating such kind of moments. So sometimes it's not moments of L function, but moments of products of different periods, and the periods are sometimes only the square roots of values of L function. But nevertheless, this has occurred in nature. But okay. So let's say what we have about this second moment of Dirichlet L function. So when the modulus is prime, so we have this for the case of the second moment, so we have a pretty complete set of results. So if you take any pairs of non-zero integers and you take Q a prime, then you can average, you can compute asymptotically this mixed moment. And so what you get is you get a log Q factor, but only when you have a perfect matching between the positive and the negative. So you have a, you evaluate the square of an L value on average of the, say, the eighth power of chi, square of the modulus. Then you get a factor log Q, as we had for the square of the modulus with, say, A is equal to 1. And then you get a constant, which...
The order of chi. Because if the order of chi, for instance, is A, you have L1, there is no problem with the order of chi. And
no, no, because you vary over chi, so A is fixed. So you, at some point, your chi to the A, if you vary chi, it won't be, chi to the A won't be the trivial character. Most of the time, it won't be trivial if you vary over chi. A is fixed here, so. Of course, there is some arithmetic involved regarding whether A and B divide Q minus one, but in fact, you don't see this here. Oh, maybe there is, yeah, no, no. As Q get large, no. Okay, so you have you have some again complete results, and this is so this this theorem it is part of it's some advertisement. So there is a special issue in Acta Arithmetica for Henrik, and so this is the paper that we have sent to Acta, and we are very happy that they accepted the paper. So. And very proud. And so this is the second moment. And what? And then we can also say something with cubic moments. So and now this is also with Will Sawin. So let's say we will compute these cubic moments where all the exponents are non-negative, are positive. And maybe at the end I will say what happens with when some exponents are negative, but you have complex conjugate. So and then we can compute this cubic moment if A plus B plus C is congruent to 1 mod 2, or we can say something. So in general, what we can say is that at least the real part of this mixed moment is not too small, it's at least one, and plus rapidly decaying error term. And if by chance two of our exponent match, so if say B equals C, so then it means that the two factors here, they match and they become a square, then we have a complete evaluation, again, with a power saving error term. And likewise, then if you have this square, then you could replace this L function square by a twisted L function.
Philippe, sorry to interrupt. There is a question in the chat. Akash, would you like to unmute and ask away?
Oh, yeah, thank you. So I was just wondering, in the last result on this one, are the implied constants allowed to depend on A, B, and C, or are these results also uniform in A, B, and C?
Here, for instance,
yeah, this one.
Oh, yeah,
this
it depends one. On A, B, and C, and even the delta depends on A and B. And so, or at least our ability to evaluate this, our exponent is, you see, is decaying, is getting worse and worse as the exponent.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, there is some dependency in A and B. Yeah. We cannot do it's very, it's so, yeah.
I see. Okay. Right. Thank you.
So for us, A and B are fixed, and in all these, they will be fixed.
Right. Thank you.
Okay, I will explain the proof of this theorem and what is going in to the proof. Maybe one thing you can see is that we have this with this strange condition that A plus B plus C has to be odd. So in particular, we cannot say anything about the 1, 2, 3 moments. Unlike Pliego, okay, we hope we will be able to say something soon, but I will explain where we have this dichotomy on the parity of A plus B plus C. Okay, so maybe some corollaries of this result is that if you use so usual methods of modification, Hölder inequality, and you use Mats Jung's work on the fourth moment, then you can achieve non-vanishing results. So, for instance, you have a result that a positive proportion of these Dirichlet characters are such that the product of two L value do not vanish. Okay, here you have a positive proportion of simultaneous non-vanishing, and here you have chi to the A and the chi to the B, with A and B not necessarily the same, so it's not really completely obvious. If you have one factor, then the positive proportion of non-vanishing, it is, we learned it from the work of Ivaniak and Sarnak, who, and this is where I learned the modification technique. And so we can reproduce it here with two factors and with some. And if you have a free cubic moment, if your exponents are all distinct, then you can not achieve a positive proportion, but you have this q over log q to the ninth power. So it's a zero proportion, but it's still a good number of of simultaneous non-vanishing. And in the case where B is equal to C, so let's say we take two factors, but one of them is a twist of modular form by the C power of chi, then you get back this positive proportion, or you can get back this positive proportion. So in, okay, and these lower bounds, they use the what we know about the fourth moment of Dirichlet function, which is in Matt Young's work. Okay, so let's try. I want to try to explain you some ingredients of the proof. So, the first thing is that it's not too difficult to reduce to the case where A, B, and C are coprime. You just take the GCD of A, B, and C, and then you look at this GCD with respect to also with Q minus 1. And then to evaluate the general moment, it is sufficient to be able to evaluate the moment I will explain below, but with an extra, it's a twist by by the value of your character evaluated at diff roots of unity modulo Q. Okay. So, and it's not, the case with u equal 1 or u different from 1, it's not very different. So you can do both. And so from now on, I will assume that A, B, C are setwise coprime. Okay. And it would be important, this reduction, but later. So next, you what you do is that you we will evaluate separately the even and the odd the moment for the even and odd characters because as you know the functional equation depends on the parity of your characters so then it will play also with the parity of A, B, and C. But for instance, if you restrict just to the even characters, then their power will also be even. And then you form an average over a set of characters which all have the same gamma factors. So let's restrict to the case of even characters, but you can do the odd character as well. So then we use approximate functional equation for this cubic moment. So what we do is that we really group the three L values and use approximate functional equation for degree three L function. And so you get a sum of two terms. So one which is basically the beginning of the Dirichlet series, which is truncated, and a second term which contains the product of the sign of the functional equation, which are again this Gauss sum, but evaluated at the various powers of chi. Okay, and then you get the complex conjugate term. And here we will use this approximate functional equation, but we use it in an asymmetric form. So for the first sum, we use a sum of length essentially Q squared. And for the second sum, we use we take a length of essentially Q. And so the product of Q times Q squared is Q cubed, which is the conductor of your degree three L function. If you assume, of course, that chi is in generic position, that no power is a trivial character. But for this, you can deal with them very easily because this form of small subset. Okay, so we use this asymmetric functional equation. And then once we are here, we average over our Dirichlet characters. And so you average over the even characters. And so you get, you have to evaluate two sums. So the first term is the one coming from this first sum. And when you average over Dirichlet characters, you get a congruence condition. And you have this plus or minus one because you restricted to even characters or to odd characters. So you get two congruence conditions. And this sum, I will split it. So this congruence equation, it has a kind of trivial solution, which is when L, M, and N are all equal to one. So I isolate it. It's here. And then you have kind of the non-trivial congruences solution, which are really the element different from one. And what is important is that if element are not all equal to one, and if they satisfy this congruence equation, then their product has to be big. The product of LMN, in fact, L to the A times M to the B times N to the C has to be at least Q minus one. So the non-trivial solution have a little bit of size, are of size of positive power of Q. Also, this positive power could be very small if A, B, and C are large. Okay? So, and this one will be our main term. And the goal will be to show that this non-trivial solution contribute an error term. Then there is a second sum that we get, which is when you average over the second part, you see this about this sum, which contain a product of three Gauss sums. And then when you compute the average over chi, you get a sum A kind of Dirichlet series, but where the term in the Dirichlet series is an exponential sum, so this k abc of u, which looks very much like a ternary Clusterman sum. So the difference with this ternary Clusterman sum is that instead of x, y, z equal to u, you get x to the a times y to the b times z to the c is equal to u. In fact, this sum is also a Clusterman sum. We will see this later, or it's closely related to a Clusterman sum, but in more variables, as we will see. So, but in a way, we have this function modulo q. And this function modulo q is a so-called trace function. So it has incarnation in Eladic cohomology. Okay, so, but first I will deal with the first of these two sums. So M1 ABC, this one, which is apparently the simplest and which involves this congruence condition. So, and we will focus on this term on the non-trivial solution to this congruence. So what you need to do if you do partition of unity, you need to evaluate, so to count the number of solutions of this monomial congruence equation, and you need to prove this bound that the number of solutions divided by the square root of the number of terms is is a negative power of q. And what you know is that first that Lmn are less essentially than q square from the approximate functional equation, a little bit smaller, and that Lmn are not all very small, they are at least some positive power of q. Okay, so what is happening if you want to get this bound is that these Lmn, they can be quite small, and then it's very hard to do harmonic analysis on the group, on the field FQ, to try to detect this congruence condition. And really, for instance, a challenge, it would be to be able to achieve this bound where L, M, N are all of the same size and of the minimal size given by this constraint, which is this power of Q, which is with quite a small exponent if A, B, and C are, if sum of, in the case 1, 2, 3, you get 1 over 6. Okay? So it's a hard problem to do this evaluation. But one trivial remark is that you always have that this is the number of solutions of some equation, so it's only always non-negative. So from if you know that this is non-negative, then you can basically ignore it, and this is that way you get that your first sum, its real part at least is lower bounded by one. So, okay. So if you cannot do more, at least you have a positivity result. So what we have now is that if two exponents are the same, then we can achieve this bound here. So the simplest case is when all the three exponents are equal, and then they are equal to one because they are coprime. So then what you can do is you can write the product Lmn to be an integer k, and then this integer k will occur with a multiplicity which is bounded by the ternary divisor function. And then what you need to do is to count the number of solutions k congruent to 1 mod q when k is not very small. And it's an easy task because the ternary divisor function is small, and you get your error term. Okay, it's the simplest possible case. Now, if you only have that B is equal to C and then is coprime with A, then you can again group the variable M and N into a single variable, and you essentially, and you have a weight which is the classical divisor function, which is very small, so you just need to bound the same to obtain the same bound, but when you have only two variables in your monomial equation. Okay, and so this we can do. So the first thing is that you have a trivial bound, which is you fix the smallest of these two variables n and m, and you just say that the number of solutions is absolutely bounded for the other variable, and you get this very simple bound involving the minimum and the maximum. And if the minimum is smaller than the maximum with a factor which is a positive power of q, then this bound is good, okay, is what you want. So you, the trivial bound is sufficient unless the two entries L and M are close to one another. So you see the ratio is bounded by Q to the eta for some eta which is can be taken very small. So L and M are close to one another. Another way where you can do achieve the required bound is when the two variables Lm are rather big, because then you can do harmonic analysis, and then you meet some variants of the previous exponential sums, which are absolutely bounded, and then you use the trivial bound for this sum, so that they are bounded by something, by a plus c, in fact, and then you get the bound that you need. And so what remains is the case where Lm are less than Q and the product is not very big, and they are close to one another. L and M are close to one another. And this means that L and M are nearly equal and bounded by Q to the one half. Okay. And this Q to the one half, this is the so-called Polya-Vinogradov range, when it's very hard to do harmonic analysis. But fortunately, we have this beautiful result of Lillian Pierce, which she used to give the very first bound for the free torsion in ID class group of imaginary quadratic field. So she was maybe the first to beat this the trivial bound. And so this is so the technical result that she had, and in this regime here is adequate for us. Okay, so this is how we can evaluate this first sum M1ACC, where ABC when B is equal to C, where at least two of the exponents are the same. So this rather cute and deep result of Lillian Pierce. And what we would need to have would be to have an analog version of Pierce's theorem, but for monomial equation in free variables. Okay. So I don't know how to do this for the moment, but okay, it's a very, very attractive question, and which should involve very nice stuff. So, okay, so yeah, so now let me go with the second sum. So the second sum, this is really our turf, because it is a sum which involves trace function. And I recall you, so we need to bound this average, and the y is essentially q. Okay, it's really the modulus, and we want to save a positive power of q. And this we can do in all situations. It does not depend on a. Okay, in all situations when a plus b plus c is odd. So then we, Ricolio, we say we have this sort of avatar of a ternary Clostermann sum, but with exponents a, b, and c in the equation. And this function is the trace function of an Eladic sheaf over the multiplicative group. And this is a so-called convolution sheaf. You see, because you see a multiplicative convolution sheaf, you see, because you have this equation, which this monomial equation is a multiplicative convolution of three variables. And in fact, this sheaf was studied in Katz in his two books, so Gauss sum, Clostermann sums, and monodromy groups, and exponential sums and differential equation. So he studied almost everything that you could dream of in this context. And what can you say about this sheaf? So assume A, B, and C are coprime, and okay, so then the sheaf is lisse. Its rank is the sum of the three exponents, A plus B plus C. You know its ramification at zero. You know its ramification at infinity. You know it very, quite well. It is pure of weight zero, which means that this function, this trace function, is bounded by A plus B plus C. Very good. Also, the underlying representation is absolutely irreducible, and it satisfies some duality property. So the contragradient representation is closely related to the representation itself, and you have a dichotomy between A plus B plus C being even or odd. Okay, but in fact, you need a bit more than this. For this, you can compute this sum in some cases. So suppose, but I will do it more generally, let's take an exponent e such that a, b, and c all divide q to the e minus 1. So they all divide the size of the multiplicative group of the extension fq to the e. So, but imagine that e is just 1 and your q is in a specific congruence class depending on A, B, and C. Then you have the Hassett-Davenport relation, because A, B, and C are in the torsion of this multiplicative group. And so it means that the group of characters admits characters of order A, B, and C, which generate cyclic groups. And then what is happening is that your exponential sum, but when you consider it over this extension of FQ, it can be evaluated in terms of a Clostermann sum. So a Clostermann sum in A plus B plus C variables. So you have here A plus B plus C variable. Here you have an additive character and you take the sum over all your A plus B plus C variable. And then these variables, they occur with a twist where you have the various characters of order divisible by A, divisible by B, and divisible by C. So over, at least over some finite extension of FQ, your sum can be computed is essentially equal to a Clostermann sum, which is well studied and understood. And in fact, how it translates, into the fact that the underlying sheaf that you are interested in is geometrically isomorphic to a hyper-Clostermann sheaf. So it's true over a suitable extension of FQ. It may not be true over FQ, but if you go to an extension. And in general, this is all what you need, because when you want to bound sums of exponential sums, it is sufficient to know what happened in a sufficiently big extension. And so then when you know this, for instance, you can gather very important information. So you get the what are the local monodromy at zero and infinity, or you recover them, and you can also compute the so-called geometric monodromy group of this sheaf, because it will be the geometric monodromy group of this Clostermann sheaf. And here it is. It is either SL of A plus B plus C if A plus B plus C is odd, or is the orthogonal group of in A plus B plus C variable if A plus B plus C is even. And this is where, in this dichotomy, where we have our limitation on the parity of A plus B plus C. So let's assume that the A plus B plus C is odd. And then we can do again try to evaluate your sum with a dyadic partition of unity, and if you use the trivial bound, what you see is that you can solve your problem. It is sufficient to solve your problem where the product of the three variable that you want to evaluate is very close to Q. So let's say it's equal to Q. So then it narrows, and because the rest, just by the trivial bound that this sum is bounded by A plus B plus C, it's sufficient to take care of the smaller terms. So now if you are there, you have to bound non-trivially a trilinear sum, a sum in three variables with these monomials. So if one of these variables, say n, is bigger than square root of q, a little bit bigger, then you can use the Polyavinogradov method, and this is sufficient for you. So as long as, it should be inverted, it's q to the 1/2 over n. So as long as n is a bit bigger than q to the 1/2, you are the bound that you need. And in fact, you need more, and you have this theorem about these trilinear sums, okay, in these three variables, and imagine L, M, N are size Q, then you can bound them by the trivial bound, and then you have this extra saving in general, or you have this extra term, extra factor, and you see that this extra factor is less than one if some product mn is bigger than square root of q, a little bit bigger than square root of q, and if l is a little bit bigger than one, because you can take k to be very large, and you win something. Okay, so this is not completely obvious, the proof of this result. And it's obtained by making some change of variable. So m to the b times n to the c, we say, oh, it's a variable over fq. And then we will count with multiplicity. And to deal with this multiplicity issue, we use Hölder inequality to a big exponent, so 2 to the k. And then we get things which are sums of products of this of the trace function that we want to deal with. And to get good bounds for these sums of products, we need to use the fact that the geometry monodromy group is an SL. Okay, and if you have done this, you see that all what remains is you need to bound your sum in three variables, but only when one variable is nearly bounded, is close to one, and the two variables are of size q to the 1/2. And so this is precisely the so-called Polyavinogradov range, where it is very difficult to do something non-trivial, because it's really the range of where I don't know of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle occur, or where it's the fact that the Riemann hypothesis, the any L function has zero on the critical line, and you cannot avoid them. So, but for this, we have the following theorem, which tells you that now we are reduced to a bilinear sum when both variables have a size square root of Q, and we have this theorem, which gives you a saving. So this is a trivial bound, and then this is the saving, and you see that the saving will come from here, and you see that we can save some positive power of Q as long as m times n square is a bit bigger than Q. So, and in our situation, m and n are of size q to the 1/2, so m n square is of size q to the 3/2, so we have more than enough to get our saving. Okay, so, and so I will, we have a version for the so-called type 2 sum that I will pass, and what I just want to say is that, so to prove this theorem and the other one, we use a technique which go back to Karatsuba and Vinogradov, and which was also used by Friedlander Ivaniec when they did the ternary divisor function in arithmetic progression. This is this plus UV shifting trick. And okay, I will not elaborate too much. I have a description and I will post the notes. And in the end, what after doing the trick, what do you need to evaluate? You need to be able to bound a sum of over these vectors, these tuples V, of this sum sigma 1, which is here. So what is this sum? This is a sum in two variables, R and S over FQ, of a product of 2k copies kind of the trace function we are interested in, and it's just that there are some modification which depend on this parameter v of this vector v which is here. Okay, and we have these two variable sum, and it's an sum of trace function in two variables. So what can we say about it? What we can say is that there is a variety of these parameters V. So first, there is a subvariety of diagonal elements for which the sum is just can only trivially bounded by Q square, the number of variables. So if you are in this diagonal thing, for instance, imagine that V1 is V prime 1, V2 is V prime 2, etc. Vk is V prime k. This sum cannot be bounded better than Q square. So then there is a variety where the V are in a more general position. They are not along diagonals. And then you get a better bound, you save a factor square root of Q over the trivial bound. And you can do this in this variety, which is still not very good. It's called bad. And it's, but its dimension is bounded by 3K over 2. And you are in a space of parameters of dimension 2K. So you this variety, which is a bit better, but not very good, it has a relatively small dimension. And you have a good variety, the complement, which is really very good, in which the saving that you get is really the square root of the number of terms. So instead of Q square, you get Q. So, and if you use this theorem, then you have you can get this bound. And if you choose things correctly, just to equate this term with this term, you get the bound that you need, and which concludes the treatment of the second sum in complete generality. Okay, so I will finish. I am over time, but Okay. So what we use, we have another paper when we deal with hypercluster Mansum with Will and Emmanuel in PISA, and we use the same method, but we need some variant. And in this, there we need again very crucially to know that the monodromy group is an SL, group, because we use some Goursat type criterion. And in the case where A plus B plus C is even, say the 1-2-3 case, the monodromy group is orthogonal, and this orthogonal group is not connected, and even its connected component is not simply connected, and this creates problems with our analysis. And so we hope we can overcome these problems, but at the moment we are not completely sure. And yeah, so it's a very funny, in some sense, so far we have been very lucky in analytic number theory that all these exponential sums, at least the one for which you need a very powerful treatment, they have as a monodromy group SL. But then this open a new maybe era where we will try to, one will try to apply the existing technique to sums which are of orthogonal type. And so just, yeah, okay. Maybe I'm over time. Okay, one can do also the case where the sign of the exponent are different. Okay, this is a slide called thank you. So thank you very much.